All right, can somebody say la, 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 la? Now get your prophetic bony finger out and tell your neighbor, favor is coming your way. We're going to continue our series on divine encounters, and I feel like preaching here this morning. And I'm going to preach from Ruth chapter 2 in this service and then Ruth chapter 3 in the next service. How many like the book of Ruth? Ruth means beautiful. Let me just give you this before we read the verse. If you're taking notes, Ruth means beautiful. Can somebody say, I'm beautiful? Okay, some of the guys. I didn't hear the ladies. I heard the ladies, but I didn't hear the guys. Just say, I'm handsome. Okay, I'm handsome. All right. But Ruth means beautiful. Ruth is a type in the Old Testament of the church, of us. We once were outsiders. We once were outcasts. But then we met our Boaz, Jesus, who would, Boaz is a type. I'm just throwing this on the front end so you catch where I'm going. Boaz is a type of Jesus, our kinsman redeemer. And so if you were in the second service last week, the two sermons that I'm doing today are connected to the two sermons last week. So you're going to have to listen to all four to get the whole combination together. But we talked about, and you have to listen to Wednesday night, because last week in the second service, I preached on the whole concept of redemption. And then Pastor Nick took it in Ephesians and brought in chapter 1 and verse 7, right, about redemption in that. And he's just laid down a wonderful word on redemption. There's something about redemption. There's something about God redeeming us from our forfeited inheritance. I'm not going to get into that, but somebody say Boaz. So if Ruth means beautiful, some people are taking notes. Boaz, I'm giving this on the front end, then we're going to tell a story because this is our storyteller series. Boaz has a powerful name. First of all, it means this: God establishes in strength. Ooh, this is good stuff. How does God establish you? In strength. So we have this feminine side of Ruth, who is the bride, and we have Boaz, who is this sign of strength in the man. That's powerful, right? And so watch this. He, Jehovah, God, establishes in strength. But here's what the strength is. If you really study up Boaz, it's very interesting. It's swift strength. So when he comes, you might be in trouble. You might be going through difficulty, and when Jehovah, the kinsman redeemer, arrives, he doesn't just come in strength, he comes quickly, and he moves swiftly. I got a prophetic word for somebody in this room. Somebody's going to catch this here. The Lord is going to move swiftly in this next season in your life. You've positioned yourself, oh my goodness, you have got your heart right, you've cleaned up some things, and you've got to the right place at the right time, and you are about to meet your Boaz. And Boaz moves in strength, but he moves with swift strength. Okay, all right. Stand with me for the reading of the word. We're going to read Ruth chapter 2, and I'm only going to take a portion of it. We're going to read verses 18 through the end of the chapter, through 23. And so get your reading voices on, because this is powerful scripture. And ready? Then she took it up and went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw. She took it up. Somebody say, took it up. She took up an inheritance. She took up a blessing. She took up the favor, ready? And her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. So she brought out and gave to her what she had kept back after she had been satisfied. And her mother-in-law said to her, where have you, somebody say that, where have you gleaned today? And where did you work? Blessed be the one who took notice of you. Ooh, that's a prophetic word right there. Woo, there's favor on your life. So she told her mother-in-law of whom she had worked and said, the man's name, you have to read it like it's romantic. This is a rom-com up in here. The man's name with whom I work today is Boaz. You have to say it like that, Boaz. Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, blessed be he of the Lord who has not forsaken his kindness to the living and the dead. And Naomi said to her, ooh, this is a good conversation. This man is a relation of ours, one of our close relatives. Ruth the Moabitess said, he also said to me, you shall stay close by my young men until they finish all my harvest. And Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, it is good, my daughter, that you go out with this young woman and that people do not meet you in any other field. So stay close by the young women of Boaz to glean until the end of barley harvest and wheat harvest. And she dwelt with her mother-in-law. Be seated if you can. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to hear your word. Speak today, for your servants are listening, in Jesus' name. And somebody said, now say this with me, favor is coming your way. Point to yourself, tell yourself, favor is coming your way. So what is favor? Favor, the definition of favor is to cause one to prosper, to succeed, or to flourish beyond their own experience or ability. There's something that happens when favor comes upon you. In Psalms, if you're writing notes, Psalms chapter 30 and verse 7 says, Lord, by thy favor, thou hast made my mountain to stand strong. I love that. In Psalms 84 and verse 11, it says, for the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing, I love this verse here, no good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. Psalms 90 and verse 17 says, may the favor of the Lord our God rest upon us. And I love this. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. Can somebody say favor is coming your way? Come on, you got to preach with me. Favor is coming your way. See, favor, when it comes on your life, it makes the ordinary extraordinary. When favor comes on your life, it takes what is common, what is mundane, what is usual, and it all of a sudden makes it special. It makes it valuable. It makes it rare. It's amazing when favor comes upon. It's amazing. God chose the foolish things, the base things, the things that are despised, the things that are not to put down, the things that are, because favor is upon your life. If you're writing scriptures again, Psalms chapter 5 and verse 12 says, for you, O Lord, will bless the righteous with favor. You will surround him with a shield. There's protection with the favor of the Lord. There's victory over your adversaries with the favor of the Lord. There's wealth that is stored up with the wicked with the favor of the Lord. In Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 23, it says of Naphtali, he said, O Naphtali, satisfied with favor and full with the blessing of the Lord, possess thou the west and the south. There's favor. See, favor causes all of a sudden, it causes men to give into your bosom, pressed down and shaken together and overflowing. He will cause it to come into your life exceeding abundantly. It comes upon your life. Somebody say, favor is coming your way. And so we're talking about chapter 2 of Ruth, but let me give you chapter 1 real quick, because I actually have a book in my computer with the entire book of Ruth, and it's called Favor is Coming Your Way, Moving from Emptiness to Fullness. Is anyone ready to move from emptiness to fullness? And emptiness, we're not just talking about your pocketbook, we're talking about your soul. We're talking about your life, moving from emptiness to fullness. And so when you look in Ruth chapter 1, all right, you know me, I'm going to rhyme, right? So you want me to give you the four chapters here? Here, there's four chapters in the book of Ruth. So chapter 1, favor comes through a choice. Chapter 2, favor comes through a voice. Chapter 3, favor comes through, so rejoice. That's next service. We're going to rejoice next service. And then favor comes, chapter 4, through your loins. And so you look, this is a story of favor. And so in chapter 1, we know that there was a famine in the land. I'll talk about famine in the next service. But there was a famine in the land. And so when there's no rain, there's no grain. And so you realize that a man named Elimelech, somebody say Elimelech. Elimelech means my daddy is the king. And so he married a woman named Naomi. Her name means pleasant. So you have my daddy is the king married to a woman named Pleasant. And they leave the house of bread, Bethlehem, to go to Moab. Bethlehem means what? House of bread. What does Moab mean? Moab is a question. Mo means who is, and Abba means your daddy. And so Moab means who's your daddy? So why in the world, if your name is my father is the king, would you go to a land called who's your daddy land? You know who your daddy is. He's the maker of heaven and earth. He owns the cattle on a thousand hills. But it's amazing what people do in the time of famine, in the time of drought, in the time where there's no rain. They make decisions that are outside of their character and out of what they know. And they go places and they do things that they're not supposed to do. And what happens is it might not only affect you because Elimelech died, but it affects your children because Mahlon and Chilion, his sons, died too. You have to be careful what decisions you make. And so all of a sudden, in three verses, all of the men are knocked out of the story. And so all you have now is Naomi, Pleasant, and the two daughter-in-laws, Ruth and Orpah. And it's amazing because Ruth and Orpah, Naomi's going back to Bethlehem now. She heard there's rain and there's a harvest coming. And so she said, I'm going back home. I can't stay in who's your daddy land. This didn't work out. And so I'm going back to the house of bread. I'll talk about the house of bread in the next service because there's something powerful that God wants to show us. But she is moving back to the house of bread. So she goes, girls, stay here. This is your home. And we realize that Ruth and Orpah, they were sisters, and their daddy was a man named Eglon. And Eglon was the man whom Ehud, the judge, the second judge of Israel, the left-handed judge, the Benjamite, came and he assassinated Eglon. That was Ruth's daddy. And so she was of royal lineage. Oh, we'll talk about that. But here in this story, we realize that Naomi says, stay here, this is where you're from. And the Bible says Orpah kissed, and in the Septuagint, I'm giving you Bible college knowledge here, the Greek version of the Old Testament, it's the same word kissed where Judas kissed Jesus in the garden. Oh, goodness. It's a kiss of, see you, wouldn't want to be you. I'm outie 5,000. You know what I'm saying? I'm outie. Hasta la vista, Jesus. And so Ruth, though, clung unto Naomi. And all of a sudden, she made one of the most powerful covenants in Scripture. Where you go, I go. Where you lodge, I lodge. Your people, my people. Your God, my God. Where you die, I'll die. Woo! And nothing's going to stop me from doing this. She made a covenant, and so she goes with Naomi, and as she's going along, Naomi says, don't call me Pleasant any longer. Call me Bitter. Call me Mara. I'm changing my name. It's amazing how when you go through a loss of produce and a loss of persons, that you'll get to a place where there'll be a loss of personality. Oh, loss is a terrible thing. And so she says, I'm changing my personality, my image. I'm changing my hairdo. So don't call me Pleasant no more. Call me Bitter. And so she goes back, and Ruth, and here's how the last verse ends, and I have a gift for everybody that the ushers are about to give. So get ready, ushers, because it says in that verse that Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, returned with her at the beginning of the barley harvest. Now, I have gifts for everybody in this room. Everybody's getting a bag of barley. Because by the time we're done with this service, that bag of barley is going to be evidence in your hand of the harvest that God's about to release in your life. So go ahead and hand it out. Go ahead and hand it. Hey, give them some barley. Go ahead and give them some barley. Somebody say, at the beginning. at the beginning. Do you realize that, where are we? What month are we in? August. Do you realize that the barley harvest is in September and October? That we're in a prophetic moment here right now, and there's a prophetic announcement that's being released in this house right now, that we're stepping into September and October, and we're stepping into a harvest season. Can somebody say amen? Okay. And so you're getting your barley, and when you get your barley, in a minute here, we're gonna do something with it. But here's what happened. I want you to catch this. Naomi said in 21, I went out full. She left Bethlehem, and she came back empty. Can somebody say that? I went out full, but I came back empty. Have you ever gone through a season in your life where it seemed like you were full, but you accidentally made the wrong decision? Woo! And she comes back empty. Emptiness was a sign of shame for her. But here she is in this place. God brought them out of Moab into Bethlehem. They came back to Bethlehem. I got an announcement for somebody in this house. You need to hear this, that God is able to turn the tables. If you don't hear me tell the rest of this story, you need to hear in your life, in the situations that you're dealing with your children, whatever it may be, God is able. Can somebody say that? God is able to turn the tables. So even if you feel unstable and you feel unable, you feel disabled, or you feel even labeled, God is able to turn the tables. Can somebody tell somebody beside you that? God is able. Do you have your barley? Okay, show me your barley. Now just practice. Just kind of wave it. Wave it. Wave it. Okay, wave it. Just, yeah, wave. Wave your barley in the air. Okay, good. Because Ruth arrives in this place. Can I teach for a minute? Is this okay? She arrives in Bethlehem at the beginning. You need to understand where you are strategically in the timing of God for your life. It's a fresh beginning. It's a new beginning. Oh, I got an announcement for somebody's getting this. And it's the beginning of the barley harvest. You see, favor will put you where you need to be and who you need to be with so that you can see the fullness of what God has for you in your life. Favor will put you at the right place, at the right time, with the right people. Esther, favor will put you in the courts of the king. Joseph, favor will put you as second in command over all of Egypt. Nehemiah, favor will put you as a cupbearer to the king so you can bring redemption to the people in Israel. Ruth, favor will take you out of Moab and put you into Babylon. And so here is Naomi, here is Ruth, and they're returning into Bethlehem at the beginning of the barley harvest. And I see it like this. I see Ruth arriving in Bethlehem at night. She goes to bed, her first sleep in the house of bread. And then the next morning she awakens, and I want you to catch this here. She awakens in a place of shalom. She awakens in a place of peace. She awakens in a place where there's nothing missing, nothing broken, the absence of everything harmful, the presence of everything good, because every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, in whom there's no shadow of turning and there's no variableness. He says, guess what? I'm not turning on what I spoke over your life. I watch over my word to perform it. And my word will not return void, but it will accomplish what I sent it out to do. That's a good place for somebody to say, yeah. Yeah. That's a good place for somebody to lift your hand and say, amen. Yeah. And so I love it because here's Ruth, and she's in the land flowing with milk and honey. And I think she woke up and she felt favor for the first time. And she had a favor smile on her face. Can somebody give me a favor smile? I need somebody to model it for me. Just give me a favor smile. Pastor Alexander, you got to give me a favor, smile. Come on. You got the best smile in the room. Come on. Pastor, come on. Stand up. Stand up. Stand on the chair, in fact, so everyone can see it. And just, this is a favor smile right here. Watch this right there. That's a favor smile. There's favor. There's a favor in her step. In fact, she's probably skipping along. There's a favor upon her. She has a favor song on her lips. She's saying a scripture like Psalm 119, verse 58 through 60 that says, I entreated your favor with my whole heart. Be merciful, watch this, to me according to your word. I thought about my ways and turned my feet to your testimonies. Watch this. I made haste and did not delay to keep your commandments. There's something powerful when you get a revelation of God's favor on your life. She said, it says in that scripture, I made haste and I did not delay. Can I give somebody just an inside scoop in this season? This is a season where you just can't sit back and just be like, I wonder. No, don't wonder. Just move into his wonders. Make haste. Don't delay. Somebody needs to hear this today. Don't delay. God spoke his word. He's given you his promise. Get off of the sideline. You're not supposed to be a bench warmer. You're supposed to be on the floor scoring points. Don't be a spectator. Come on now. Ministry is not a spectator sport. The call of God in your life is not a spectator sport where you're just kind of just waiting. You know, I'm just waiting. No, don't just wait. Get into the game. Step into your purpose and make haste. Do not delay because it's going to open up a whole new world for you. And so here's Ruth. She wakes up in the morning, her first day in Bethlehem, and she's like, Naomi, I'm in the right place, but now direct me to the right field. I need to get to a place where I'm supposed to do what I'm supposed to do. And so here all of a sudden, favor from choice moves to a voice. Favor comes through a voice. Can somebody say that? Favor comes through a voice. And so here is Ruth. Her choice leads to a voice. Oh, we get to chapter 3. Leads to rejoice. And leads to your loins. It's powerful stuff. But all of a sudden, her choice leads to a voice. And Ruth needed a voice. How many have ever had a word from God? It confirms something in your spirit. You knew that it was there, but there was an articulation that was given that opened everything up, and now you can move with confidence. And so here she is, and I love it because she's talking to Naomi, and Naomi speaks four times in the chapter, in the four chapters of Ruth. Naomi speaks a go word to Naomi. Make haste, don't delay. And this time, because last time she said, we're going home. But this time she says, and this is what I want to give you. Number one, favor comes through a voice. It's a voice of release. You're not going to be bound up, held up, sitting down on the sideline any longer. Naomi begins to release something inside of Ruth's spirit. And she says, go, my daughter. Go to the field, and I love it because all she needed was just let me move on. Let me have a release in my spirit to be able to step into my purpose. And verse 3, she just moved on it. I love people who just move on things. God gives you a word, and you just move on it. The word shema in the Hebrew not only just means to hear. It's the word for listen or hearing, but it also means to hear, do. And so there's no division between hearing the word of the Lord and doing the word of the Lord. If I heard it, that means I do it. I make haste, woo, and I do not delay. This is good preaching right here. What did he eat in Louisiana? Well, I had some redfish with some Cajun spices on it. Then I had some blackened catfish the next night. Oh, Jesus, okay. He's preaching like he's from Louisiana. But verse 3 says this of chapter 2. Then, we're talking about Ruth, she left, went and gleaned in the field after the reapers, and it happened, can somebody say it happened? it happened. She happened to come to a part of the field belonging to Boaz. I have to read it like that because it's kind of funny language here. She happened accidentally, inadvertently, unintentionally. I love it in the King James Version. How many like the King James once in a while? It's an old school version. She happened to light upon the field, which was Boaz's. Isn't that wonderful language right there? She just happened to be there. And for her, it might felt like an accident, but her motives were pure. But with God, it was not an accident. Of all of the fields, of all of the farms, of all of the places that she could land in Israel, it's amazing that God sometimes, in our estimation, will accidentally land us in a place that we're supposed to be. God is not a God of happenstance. He orders our starts and he orders our stops. Oh, I got a witness up in here. He watches over every step that I take. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. He ordered my steps. Remember that song back in the day? Order my steps in your word, oh God. Order my steps. There's something about understanding that your steps are ordered by the Lord. And that there are no mistakes, there's no happenstances, that God is in it. The devil is not in the details. The Holy Ghost is in the details. He's in every detail of your life. He's in every breath that you take, in every thought that you think, in every second that you live. The Holy Spirit's in them. He's feeling like he's preaching like he's just came from Louisiana. And so Ruth happens to fall on this field, and this is what we call, watch this, this is going to be amazing language. This is, I got to whisper this, it's a setup. Your life is a setup. Woo, your birth is a setup. The family that God allowed you to come up through is a setup. Ooh, come on now. Your personality, it's a setup. Your calling, it's a setup. Your giftings, it's a setup. Your anointing, it's a setup. It's all a setup. And the people God connected with you with, the relationships that you have, it's a setup. And so you can look at your setback and know that it's a setup for your comeback. And so all the things that the enemy tries to use to move you this way and that way, and the warfare that you're dealing with, and some of the poor decisions that you made in certain times, God will get you back on track. Come on, Naomi. Call me Mara. God will get you back on track. You had to go all the way to Who's Your Daddy Land. And you lost a few things, but God will get you back on track. And so pray for that wayward son. Pray for that daughter that is out there right now, because God, when there's a seed that's sown, we got to believe that that seed is going to come back to fruition. Oh, he's preaching up here. And she begins to glean. And you see, back in the day, in Moses' day, God established a law in Leviticus 19. It's the law of gleaning. And the law of gleaning basically says this: when a man is harvesting his field, he is to allow, set aside, and permit the four corners of his field to remain unharvested, so that the poor, the widow, and the stranger could glean in the field. God puts a provision in every one of our fields, in the four corners of our fields, for the poor and the widow and the stranger. And so there was, watch this, the four corners were limited. They weren't like the middle, but there was a provision. And so Ruth understood this law, coming into Bethlehem, and she knew that she could get a supernatural supply. And it's amazing to me because, somebody's going to catch this. Ruth actually fulfilled all three categories of the law in Leviticus 19. She was poor. In fact, she wasn't poor. Drop the O-R. And she was a widow. And she was a stranger. She was a Moabitess. And so it's amazing. Have you ever found yourself fitting all of the categories? And she was overqualified. She just needed one to get in the door. But she was financially, she had lost her financial security. She had lost her identity. She had lost her husband. And she comes in here and she doesn't know anybody but Naomi. See, I need to encourage somebody in this room that labels are coming off. There's a harvest for everyone. Categories are being replaced. Classifications and limitations are coming off. And Ruth begins to glean. Somebody say glean. Do you have your barley, by the way? And there is a man that owns the field that sees Ruth gleaning. And the Bible basically says he noticed her. He took note of her. Boaz saw girlfriend Ruth in his field. See, I need to tell somebody that you don't have to put on something skimpy to get his attention. You don't have to get yourself a short skirt and a halter top and show your midriff. You don't have to go out of your way to get him to notice you. Here's how God works. God chooses people who are working. Elisha in the field with the oxen. Come on now. Peter fishing and Jesus comes on the scene. Moses tending his father-in-law's sheep. David tending his father's sheep. God always notices something, people who are working. And so Boaz is like, let me see this girl. I need to do my homework on her. If you're looking to get with somebody, do your research. This is a singles conference now. Do your research. Get some wisdom. And you look in the Hebrew commentaries of Ruth chapter 2, and you find that Boaz went to three groups of people. He went to her supervisors. He went to the sages of Israel, the people of wisdom, and he went to the seers, the prophetic people. He did his homework. He didn't just do one little piece of homework. He did his research. He went to her supervisors. In the Hebrew commentary, it says he went to sages and he wanted wisdom. And he went to the prophetic team to get a prophetic word about who this girl is. And it's amazing because in this moment, he's talking to her. He sees her. He's doing his homework. And we realize that, again, favor comes through a voice. And the first voice that she got was a voice of release. But now when Boaz enters the scene, it's a voice of increase. I got to speak to somebody in this room that God is not only releasing you into your purpose, but he's releasing his increase in your life. Okay, three people want that. That's okay. But he basically tells her, he's like, hey girl. You know, it's like boys to men, you know, the deep voice. Girl, you know it's true. You come to my field. You sit at my table. You drink from our cups. You eat from our food, girlfriend. And Ruth, in the scripture, when he talks to her, immediately translates what Boaz is saying to favor. Because her answer to him is this: why have I found favor in your sight? In other words, I fit all of the categories. I'm to be written off. I'm poor. I'm a widow. I'm a stranger. Why have I found favor in your sight? And this is when Boaz reveals that he did his research. Because he says, it has been fully reported to me by the supervisors and the sages and the seers. The supervisors told me of what you did when nobody else was looking, and how you served your mother-in-law, not for fame, not for a game, not for money, not for anything. You served her when nobody else was there. And so when I spoke to your supervisors, they spoke a word of honor over your life. And then when I spoke to the sages, I needed some wisdom. I needed them to tell me how this thing is going to work out, because I'm checking you out to see if we can get married. And not only did she get a word of honor, but she also got a word of identity, because they began to speak and say categories are coming off, because he had to check her background and say, can I even marry a Moabitess woman? Because I know in the law it says that we're not supposed to intermarry with Moabites, but you look and realize that that was a provision only for men. And so he needed a word of wisdom. And then he also got a word of destiny, because he talked to the seers, and in the Hebrew, in the Targum, there was a prophecy about Ruth. And it said this, that out of her will come kings. And when we look into the future, we realize that out of her came kings, but not only kings, but the King of Kings, the Lord. Oh, this is good preaching right here. Of lords, Jesus, the King of glory, woo, was coming out of her. And so she not only got, he gave her a word of honor and a word of identity, but also gave her a word of destiny. When nobody else was looking, categories are coming off of you. And I understand where all this is going. And so Boaz, the voice of increase, speaks a prophetic word over her and says, you eat at my table, you stay in my field, for this is the year of your favor. And Eugene Peterson says it like this in verse 15 and 16. He says to his servants, he says, give her special treatment. In other translation, it says, leave heaps on purpose for her. And so he's directing his people. He's like, you better take care of this girl or you're going to get fired. You're going to give her special treatment. Can I tell somebody that you're moving into a season in God where you're going to receive special treatment? Has anyone ever been to the spa and you get special treatment? They do your nails and they do your feet. And I don't like them touching me, but my wife likes that stuff, but there's special treatment. Some of you need to, with your spouse, you need to give them some special treatment. You talk nicely to them and kindly to them and go buy them a schmuck or something. And here's what he did. Can you come over here, Pastor? I have Pastor Latoya is playing Ruth here today. Okay, so I'm gonna have you come in a second. He gives girlfriend 5 gallons of barley to take back to Naomi. Watch this. Hold on. And has anyone ever seen The Wiz? Okay, so there's The Wizard of Oz, right? And Dorothy, you know, the old school Wizard of Oz back in the day. What was her name? Judy Garland. You've seen that? There's the Wizard of Oz. And follow the yellow brick road. Right? But then there's another version of the African-American persuasion called The Wiz. And Dorothy is no longer Judy Garland, but is Diana Ross. And there is a certain scarecrow played by one young Michael Jackson. And there's a certain scene where they're on the yellow brick road. She pulls him up, gets him out of that place where he was stuck, and brings him to the yellow brick road. And all of a sudden, he's kind of just trying to find his feet. You know, Michael Jackson just. And when they get on the road, there's a song that starts to play. Ease on down the road. Oh, see, some of you, I'm stirring something up here. Ease on down the road. But I have this image, right? So Ruth gets this 5 gallons, and she met Boaz. And she gets this 5 gallons of and she, you can't carry. Well, a lady, man, I can't carry 5 gallons. I know some of you can, but 5 gallons, going a couple miles, that's a long way. So we got a wheelbarrow, cobalt, in Jesus' name. But here's how I view her. She's not just walking back with the 5 gallons. It's ease on down. And so I had to sanctify it. So I found a different song of one named Donnie McClurkin. And he wrote this song, and he says, and we're going to play it because you're going to dance in here. You're going to wave your barley, and we're going to go out the door rejoicing. Because there ain't no party like a barley harvest party, because a barley harvest party don't stop. I'm walking in authority, living life without apology. It's not wrong, dear. I belong here, so you might as well get used to me. I'm walking in prosperity, living life the way it's meant to be. It's not wrong, dear. I belong. Somebody say, I belong here, so you might as well get used to me. And there's a certain part in the song, we'll play it, you'll get to hear it, and they just start singing, la, 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 la. You know that part? La, 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 la. And that's the part where you get your weight, and get out something, he says in the song, and begin to wave it, and it's the barley. And it's so prophetic because in Israel, when the harvest came, what would they do? They would bring a wave offering. They that sow in tears are going to reap in joy, and they're going to doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing their seeds with them. There's something about waving and celebrating the goodness of the Lord. See, she's about to lead us in this wheelbarrow dance up in here, but let me tell you something. Ruth gets back. La, 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 la. La, 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 la. She's not just... See, there we go. Ease on down. Ease on down. Whoo! And so Ruth arrives. Somebody say, Ruth arrives. You're gonna have to hear the second one because this is just the start. And she gets into the house, and Naomi says, girl. Sorry, this is 2024 vernacular. Girl, where did you go today? Boaz. Where did you get all of this? Boaz. You know that's our kinsman redeemer. What did he say? He said, I can stay. I want you to hear this. I can stay. This is not just a one-time blessing. His favor endures for a lifetime. It's not about, actually not about food or provision. There's a provision that's being made that's taking this poor widow stranger and grafting me into a line and giving me a name when I did not have a name. And it gave me a people when I did not have a people. And it gave me an identity when I didn't have an identity. And it gave me honor when I did not have any honor. It brought me in and it gave me a destiny when I thought it was all over. I looked all over and I found nobody greater than my kinsman redeemer. And he said, I can stay. and I could stay. And Naomi says, this is good. Don't go to any other field. There's a voice of release, woo, and a voice of increase. Can somebody say that? A voice of release and a voice of increase. So I wrote a rhyme, and I don't know how good it sounds because I didn't really look at it after, but when you hear the voice of release, anxiety and fear must cease. You meet the voice of increase, and it gives you supernatural peace because you are the centerpiece of God's masterpiece, so you can tell every enemy and foe that speaks, devil, please, you best back off. These are my streets. I got a front row seat. I got a front row seat of a divine destiny that keeps. This is my Boaz press release. Yeah. Ease on down. Ease on down. Whoa. I can't see. I can't. Michael Jackson be like doing these spins and just. I watched the video. I was like, woo. So get your barley up. Come on, just put it in the air. And Pastor, you're gonna be coming back to Boaz's house, okay? In fact, Boaz, come up here. Boaz, come up here. Come on, Boaz. So just take it slow, just move, use the whole territory, and let's go ahead and play this song. I'm walking.
I'm walking in the thorn.
And some of you might need to get up and wave your
living life without apology. Not wrong, dear.
Here's Ruth.
I belong
She's
here.
Coming back from the field.
So you might as well get used to
She's
me.
She's got a wheelbarrow of harvest.
My mother may not be the queen, but my father's king of everything. I'm adopted into the family, so I guess that makes me royalty. And it gives me dominion.
Amen. Let's give our actors a hand. See, you, some of you might have to stay for next service for parts Ruth chapter 3, but this is, what's your theme song all this week? La, 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 la. Look in the face of the enemy. La, 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 la. In the face of poverty. La, la. Is that your theme song for the week? All right, good. Let me pray for some people here before we close. So, first of all, put out your barley. Put out your barley. Just, this is a seed of what God's about to do. Are you ready for a harvest? There's a voice of release and a voice of increase. Favor comes through a voice.